Good evening. Tonight we begin day 7 of our novena to St. John Vianney for an increase in vocations to the priesthood in the Diocese of Portland and for all of our priests who serve. I first of all welcome all of you who are joining me in person here at St. Louis Church in Fort Kent, and I also welcome all those who are joining us via live stream. The theme of this evening is St. John Vianney as a warrior against Satan. And one of the things that we'll be reflecting on is, yes, John Vianney's experience with skinny red legs, as I like to call him, but it's also how we too can prepare ourselves when we are faced with some spiritual combat, if you will. Because, as we'll learn tonight, many saints have had their interactions with the devil. And for those who strive towards virtue, the devil always seeks to divert our path. So tonight, we ask for the intercession of St. John Vianney to give us the grace to be open and receptive to being spiritually combat ready in any actions that we may have against the evil one. And now I invite you at this time to recollect yourselves as we prepare to expose Jesus in the Most Blessed Sacrament. Please stand. Please kneel.
O salutaris hostia, quae caeli pontis hostium, vela praemunt hostilia, daro verfer auxilium. Uni fino quae domino, sit sempiterna,
just a reminder that if anyone here who's present at St. Louis, confession will be available. If you just make your way towards the back, towards the confessional, one of our priests will hear your confession. Day 7, Warrior Against Satan. A reading from the Gospel according to St. Luke. And Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led by the Spirit for 40 days in the wilderness, tempted by the devil. And he ate nothing in those days, and when they were ended, he was hungry. The devil said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command this stone to become bread." And Jesus answered him, "It is written, man shall not live by bread alone." And the devil took him up and showed him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time, and said to him, "To you I will give all this authority and their glory, for it has been delivered to me, and I give it to whom I will. If you then will worship me, it shall all be yours." And Jesus answered him, "It is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only shall you serve." And he took him to Jerusalem and set him on the pinnacle of the temple and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down from here, for it is written, he will give his angels charge of you to guard you, and on their hands they will bear you up, lest you strike your foot against the stone." And Jesus answered him, "It is said, you shall not tempt the Lord your God." And when the devil had ended every temptation, he departed from him until an opportune time. Day 7. Warriors Against Satan. So, in a talk, or a novena rather, that is focused on striving towards praying for priests and seeing St. John Vianney as a model for priests. It's something to do with that we should be joyful, yes, expressing joy and zeal and recognizing the great gift of his priesthood. But why did I make a talk based around the devil? Why is this significant? As we'll see shortly, one of the things that John Vianney struggled with, especially as the people of ours were converting or reverting back to their faith, the devil recognized the significance of John Vianney's actions. In a secular book, it's a wonderful book, it's controversial in a sense, but Sun Tzu's The Art of War, one of the first quotes in that book is, "Know thy enemy and know yourself. In 100 battles you will never be defeated." So to talk about the devil is to know about our enemy. And to know ourselves is to know our image and likeness in God, and how in reception of the sacraments and being in a state of grace, we know that we're always going to be stronger than the devil and will never be defeated in the battles of temptation or torment. In this modern day and age, the temptation is not to talk about the devil, but he is quite present, and we need to know that, recognize that, and act upon it. The devil has a profound sense and recognition of the presence of God. He has located him, especially here in our churches, and he knows who God is. And the devil's sole goal is to keep that secret from us. What makes saints unique is how indiscreet they were about proclaiming the secret and the goodness of God, but also the secret tactics of the devil in proclaiming that throughout the world. We're praying for priests and seminarians, and the devil hates them. He hates them especially because seminarians, they have the potential, as we like to say with philosophical language, the potential of becoming a priest. And priests they hate and detest is because by virtue of the laying of hands at ordination, they are changed and conformed to the image and likeness of God in a deep and profound way. As we mentioned in the Sacrament of Reconciliation, the Eucharist talks, that of being in the person of Christ, being the earthen vessels in which Christ brings us the gifts of the sacraments. It's through the priest, but it's the actions of God himself that makes those sacraments real. And even more so, the devil hates holy, humble, and even happy ones, because that being holy and humble and even happy really reflects how Jesus lived his life. The devil does not stop trying to steer seminarians and even priests away from being reverent, from being holy, from proclaiming the truth, and to bringing us all to right relationship with God through the sacraments. As we've mentioned before, in his first homily to his parishioners, he reminded them that hell exists. In his words, "It was not my invention. God has told us about this. And yet you pay no heed but taking part in sinful actions. From the moment of his ordination, Vianney had declared war on the devil and set about to prepare his defenses, both by his own actions in his own life, but also by building up the grace and the holiness of his parishioners. As I mentioned, the modern age has seen what the power of evil can do and how it's displayed. And it's also a time of disbelief in the existence of evil. This is going back a few years, but in 1972, St. Paul VI told nations reeling from hunger, violence, indolence, and nuclear threats that evil is not the absence of good, but it is a living spiritual being. It's a living spiritual being who is perverted, and his mission is to pervert. And what are the greatest needs of the church today? And one of the greatest needs is defense from that evil, which is called the devil. And he himself, and we can see, like especially with that of the sex scandals and other horrific acts, that even the smoke of Satan can be has entered priests and other people in the church. But there is great hope, and we'll talk about that soon. So the extraordinary events that surrounded John Vianney, and as I like to call, skinny red legs, it began in 1824 and lasted until 1858, the year before our beloved curé's death. The terror and wonder of this confrontation between someone who was so good and so holy versus someone who was so evil and so perverted was quite intriguing. Father Sandro, he's an exorcist and an authority on exorcism, wrote in a treatise that he did about the mystical state, "The devil acts on all people by tempting them. We can't escape temptations. These are his ordinary operations. But in other cases, the devil reveal their presence by troublesome vexations, which are more terrifying than painful. They cause great noise, they move, transport, knock over, and at times smash certain things. And that is what is called infestation. And then there's also another one, which is obsession, by which an individual is affected physically. And then the third is possession, by which the devil acts in and through an individual's conscience. St. John Vianney was a victim of both infestation and obsession, and he also encountered poor souls that were possessed. These infestations and obsessions of the devil with our curé of ours indicates what happens in one form or another when heroic virtue is attempted. We can read in the Gospels, as we read in the Gospels today, or the Gospel passage today, that Christ had confrontations, and victories against the devil. If we believe that the devil is real and that it is something of substance, Satan must have a virtue to enable him to exist at all. And this virtue is the virtue of taking Christ seriously. God looks on all of us who are struggling against temptation, not with condemnation, which is what the devil wants us to think, but it's with love that no human being can match. The key to this struggle against temptation and the promptings of the devil is that of humility, because pride is his weapon. It's exploited, as we can see throughout salvation history. The devil, as a spiritual being, has an intellect, but they lost the good aspect of their intellect when they disobeyed God in the beginning. They have not lost it altogether, and they do have intelligence, but it's a recognition of the power of grace, and for them this is something that they cannot stand when someone is in a state of grace. They like to exploit us with our inferior intelligence by causing us, with giving us confusing self-estimation through the falseness of pride. We can see this most prominently in the third chapter of Genesis, where the devil tempts Adam and Eve. And from there, we go along the path of salvation history. And if we look at that passage, the devil does not say, "Go ahead, Adam, go ahead, Eve, and take the fruit. Go ahead and take God's place. Eliminate him forever." But what the devil does, and this is how he works through temptation, is he suggests an idea. If you eat this fruit, you will be like him. The sin of Adam and Eve was not eating of the fruit. It was not yielding to any pleasures of the sexual sort, or was not even disobedience. But it was because of pride. They wanted to be their own. They wanted to be their own God. They wanted to have control. And to imitate the deceiver is to submit to pride. Because the devil hates the fact that God chose us to allow his only son to be like us. And when we were created to be made in the image and likeness. Even though we are faced with temptation, the church gives us four things that we can be certain about with demonic possession. The devil cannot tempt us beyond our strength. Even though we may be faced with many temptations, that of grace is stronger than any evil or any temptation that we can have. The word Satan is Hebrew for deceiver. He plots, he uses spiritual power, and he likes to confuse. His method is logical. He camouflages his purposes in excuses suited to the imagination and of our personal habits. And lastly, he can operate through human beings and human institutions. Because the devil acts as a parody of Christ, where Christ seeks to bring us all into one with him, making us branches of his vine, and establishing the church as his own body. The devil infests, obsesses, and possesses. It harms not people not by these things, but by temptation. And the paradox of the devil is that the devil is true to himself by being false to others. John Vianney, when he was beginning to have these spiritual infestations and obsessions by the devil, he didn't quite necessarily recognize them for what they were initially, which is basically annoyance from a big bully. At first, he was hearing a lot of pounding on his doors in the middle of the night. Thinking they were burglars, he assigned burglars trying to steal some of the vessels and stuff from the sacristy. He appointed a young man to act as a night watchman. And on his first night, at 1 o'clock in the morning, the banging on the door and this riotous noise, like carts rolling through the room, began. The house began to shake, and this young man quit, running away terrified. John Vianney was quite amused by this, that such a burly fellow as this young man should be terrified. But they continued to come, and the cure grew convinced that these infestations were, in fact, infestations by the fact that they frightened him. Because God does not frighten us. That is never his intention. So his response to that was to turn to God, making the sign of the cross, and addressing a few contemptuous words to the devil. He also began to recognize a pattern. The more, the louder these noises and the assaults on him became more numerous, it was a signal that someone, a big sinner, someone who is desiring to turn back to Christ, was coming. And John Vianney was like, aha, this is my big catch. It's coming tomorrow. The evil one likes to terrorize us, but he cannot terrorize us any more than he is terrified by Christ and his victory. One of St. John Vianney's favorite saints, St. Anthony, once made a reply to the demons. If you had any power, only one demon would be sufficient. But Christ has hamstrung you, and so you try to frighten by your numbers and to look bigger than you are. As holiness affirms the unity of being, evil fragments it. As I mentioned, Christ desires to make us one. One out of many people. And desires that no fragments be left over. But Satan is the anti-Eucharist who makes his oneness into many. To be legion, as is proclaimed in the Gospel. In the old rite of exorcism, the first address of the exorcist giving exorcism to someone. Evil is someone who is multiple and whose name is legion. John Vianney did not give the devil the satisfaction of calling him legion. His name for the devil was, I'm going to pronounce the French wrong, I'm sorry, but grappin, a little rake or a grating fork. He would say that this grappin is so stupid. He would tell John Vianney the arrival of a big penitent. The biggest thing that hurts the devil the most is pride, or ridiculing his pride. So other saints like Philip Neri chased him with slurs. Saint Dustin punched him in the nose. And St. Martin of Tours called his bluff when he came to disguise in the trappings of Christ. But he recognized that it was not Christ, because even though the devil looked like Christ, he did not have the humility to bear the wounds of Christ. The devil's strategy is clever, but it has no imagination or inventiveness. And once you understand its language, it can be easily deciphered. Christ mockingly called the prince of the devils Beelzebub, and Vianney rolled the name Grappin over his tongue as though he was nicknaming a naughty pet. This is one of our greatest weapons. When faced with spiritual oppression, ridiculing the evil one makes him feel awful. The devil tried to change his tactics with the cure by trying to insult Vianney, calling him a potato eater and saying that he would get him. And throughout the night, he would rattle furniture, overturn furniture, and sometimes growl like a bear or also in a seductive voice. But these infestations became obsessions. And sometimes he felt these demons running over him like rats, tossing him out of bed. But in 1826, when he was going to one of the missionary churches that he was asked to go, the atmosphere around him took on a sinister glare, and the roadside bushes glowed a sickly red color. When he arrived to the mission, there were four witnesses that saw his bed get tossed in the middle of the night, followed by sheer shrill squeals. Even his sister came to visit him one time in the rectory and heard all these noises. Vianney assured her in her startled state, "That was just the devil. He can't hurt you, he can't hurt me. He torments me in different ways, but he can't do anything. He does this because I convert souls to the good God. Even sometimes in the middle of the night, in the confessional, when no one else was in the confessional, it was just the cure, there could be dialogues between the devil and John Vianney. The devil once said, if there were three like you on earth, my kingdom would be destroyed. You have taken more than 80,000 souls from me. There was a man nearby by the name of Antoine Gay. He was a famous possessed person and died possessed, but in a state of grace. But he was approached by St. John Vianney. And on seeing this cure of ours, he dropped to his knees, shaking his fists and screaming out, Vianney, you are a thief. You are stealing from us the souls we had so much difficulty in winning. And one of the things is, like, in his tactics, the devil and his pride feels like he can keep going, and he overreaches himself. It's not because he's stupid, it's because he's ignorant. His ignorance is blinded because of his pride. And it blinds him to the extent of what God's grace can do. And so, sometimes the devil can tempt us too openly when we are on guard. He can also send us the wrong kind of temptation, or send us the right temptation at the wrong time. He also underestimates the effect of penance and our love of God and how they help us. We have reason to fear him, but yet we are not panic-stricken. And so, John Vianney knew the importance of the priesthood to expel demons, and we can see that through Christ's example in the Gospels. John Vianney's life shows us how real and how powerful this skinny red legs is, but his pathetic and evil strategies are so prevalent during his time, but even in our own time. But we also have to remember that Jesus always wins. Jesus gives us strategies to combat skinny red legs. There are weapons that we have and that we need to carry. The first one being that of humility. Because humility eliminates pride. The next one, and that is an effect of humility, is being in the state of grace. That was one of the greatest weapons that the cure of ours taught his parishioners. That being in the state of grace, the devil can't touch him. One of the greatest things when we come to receive Jesus in the Eucharist, if we don't do it in a worthy manner, it's like pouring vinegar on the wounds of Christ. But, and this is what the devil wants. He wants us to be ashamed of our grave sins and not go to the sacrament of reconciliation. To not strive towards holiness, to say, these are too much for me. I cannot do it. But John Vianney's example of encouraging people to come to the confessional, to receive the sacraments, to be in a state of prayer, they can be delivered from our sinful habits. Our weapons, as I mentioned, are humility, the sacrament of reconciliation, being close to Jesus in the Eucharist, also the three acts of fasting, almsgiving, and prayer. And it's also through the intercession of the Blessed Mother, Saint Joseph, and other saints, asking for their intercession in the time of temptation or when we feel that the devil is strongest. John Vianney invites us, and through his examples of holiness, recognizes that yes, we may indeed be tempted and faced with skinny red legs presence in our lives. But if we hold fast to the sacraments, to prayer, and always striving towards holiness, getting back up on the horse, so to speak, like John Vianney, we can laugh in the face of evil and continue towards our call to become saints. I now invite you to open your booklet to page 17 for the prayer for day 7. Saint John Vianney, the infamous attacks of the devil which you had to suffer and the trials which disheartened you by fatigue would not make you give up the sublime task of converting souls. The devil came to you for many years to disturb your short rest, but you won because of mortification and prayers. O holy priest of ours, powerful protector, you know the tempter's desire to harm the ordained, and believing soul of the priest and the discerning soul of those called to participate in that calling. By the tempting of the evil one, they may fall to sin rejecting this holy sacraments and the life of virtue. O Cure of ours, dispel from them the traces of the enemy and keep them holy and pure. Give them the spirit of mortification and prayer so as to abide in the love of Christ so that they might radiate God's love to his people. Believing in the power of your kind intercession, we humbly ask you to pray for us and the special intentions we are hoping God will grant us through this novena. In particular, we pray for an increase in vocations to the priesthood here in the Diocese of Portland, Maine. And we also pray for our priests that serve in this diocese. And at this time, I invite you to make your own intercession or intention. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. I invite you to turn to page 23 for the Litany of St. John Vianney, the Cure of Ours. Lord, have mercy on us. Christ, have mercy on us. Lord, have mercy on us. Christ, hear us. God, the Father of heaven. God, the Son, Redeemer of the world. God, the Holy Spirit. Holy Trinity, one God. Holy Mary, Mother of God. Saint John Marie Vianney. St. John Vianney, endowed with grace from thine infancy. St. John Vianney, model of filial piety. St. John Vianney, devoted servant of the Immaculate Heart of Mary. St. John Vianney, spotless lily of purity. St. John Vianney, faithful imitator of the suffering of Christ. St. John Vianney, abyss of humility. St. John Vianney, seraph of prayer. St. John Vianney, faithful adorer of the Most Blessed Sacrament. St. John Vianney, ardent lover of holy poverty. St. John Vianney, tender friend of the poor. St. John Vianney, penetrated with fear of God's judgment. St. John Vianney, fortified by divine visions. St. John Vianney, who was tormented by the evil spirit. St. John Vianney, perfect model of sacerdotal virtue. St. John Vianney, firm and prudent pastor. St. John Vianney, inflamed with zeal. St. John Vianney, faithful attendant on the sick. St. John Vianney, indefatigable catechist. St. John Vianney, who didst preach in words of fire. St. John Vianney, wise director of souls. St. John Vianney, specially gifted with the spirit of counsel. St. John Vianney, enlightened by light from heaven. St. John Vianney, formidable foe to Satan. St. John Vianney, compassionate with every misery. St. John Vianney, providence of the orphans. St. John Vianney, favored with the gift of miracles. St. John Vianney, who did reconcile so many sinners to God. St. John Vianney, who did confirm so many of the just in the way of virtue. St. John Vianney, who did taste the sweetness of death. St. John Vianney, who dost now rejoice in the glory of heaven. St. John Vianney, who give joy to those who invoke thee. St. John Vianney, heavenly patron of parish priests. St. John Vianney, model and patron of director of souls. Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world. Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world. Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world. Christ, hear us. Pray for us, blessed Jean-Marie Vianney. Let us pray. Almighty and merciful God, who did bestow upon blessed Jean-Marie Vianney wonderful pastoral zeal and a great fervor for prayer and penance, grant, we beseech thee, that by his example and intercession, we may be able to gain the souls of our brethren for Christ, and with them attain to everlasting glory to the same Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever. Amen. St. John Vianney, priest of ours, pray for our priests and pray for us.
Antum ego sacramento, venere morte nui, et anticum documento, novo cedat ritui, preste fide supplemento, sensum te. Salus honor virtus quoque, sit et benedictio, procedenti ab utroque, comparsit laudatio. Amen.
pray. O God, who in this wonderful sacrament have left us a memorial of your passion, grant us, we pray, so to revere the sacred mysteries of your body and blood, that we may always experience in ourselves the fruits of your redemption. You who live and reign with the God the Father in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen.
The Divine Praises.
Blessed be God.
Blessed be God.
Blessed be his holy name.
Blessed be his holy name.
Blessed be Jesus Christ, true God and true man.
Blessed be Jesus Christ, true God and true man.
Blessed be the name of Jesus. Blessed be his most sacred heart.
Blessed be his most sacred heart.
Blessed be his most precious blood.
Blessed be his most precious blood.
Blessed be Jesus in the most holy sacrament of the altar.
Blessed be Jesus in the most holy sacrament of the altar.
Blessed be the Holy Spirit, the Paraclete. Blessed be the great Mother of God, Mary most holy.
Blessed be the great Mother of God, Mary most holy.
Blessed be her holy and immaculate conception.
Blessed be her holy and immaculate conception.
Blessed be her glorious assumption.
Blessed be her glorious assumption.
Blessed be the name of Mary, Virgin and Mother.
Blessed be the name of Mary, Virgin and Mother.
Blessed be Saint Joseph, her most chaste spouse.
Blessed be Saint Joseph, her most chaste spouse.
Blessed be God in his angels and in his saints.
Blessed be God in his angels and in his saints.
Thank you.
This concludes day 7 of our novena for the intercession of St. John Vianney. I invite you to join us again tomorrow at night, 7 p.m. Tomorrow night for day 8. And the theme for tomorrow will be the heart of the priest is the heart of Christ. And just a reminder that in celebration of our parish patron saint, we will be having Mass at 6 o'clock on Friday. And so what a wonderful way to end this novena by receiving Jesus in the Blessed Sacrament. Look forward to seeing you all tomorrow. Thank you, and God bless.